Okay, going back to what Greg said about starting off with the fact that California has 34 electoral votes, California actually has 55 electoral votes, and it's based on two coming from, from the Senate, based on the Senate and based on the House of Representatives. Now, you can actually change your boundary lines for your district to change your number of House of Representatives to increase your number for electoral votes for smaller states. When they're saying that it should be abolished, the problem with abolishing the Electoral College is the workability. In order to abolish the Electoral College, according to Paige Whitaker and Thomas Neal of the Electoral College, an overview and analysis of reform proposals stated in the Library of Congress, the first and perhaps largest single factor in the Electoral College reform equation is Article 5 of the Constitution, which provides for its amendment, among other things. As noted previously in this report, the founders intentionally made it difficult to alter the nation's fundamental character, establishing what is the only double requirement of supermajorities in the document. Proposed amendments to the Constitution must win by two-thirds majority in both the House and both houses of Congress, and must then be approved by three-fourths of the state. In practice, the hurdle has been raised even higher, since it's customary to attach a 7-day deadline for ratification of proposed amendments. The feasibility of actually proposing to change to get rid of the Electoral College is easier said than done, because according to the U.S. National Archives, reference source indicates that over the past 200 years, over 700 proposals have been introduced into Congress to reform or eliminate the Electoral College. There have been many more proposals for the Constitution amendments or change of the Electoral College than on any other subject. With that said, over 200 years and 700 introductions of change for the Electoral College, it's definitely a daunting task, and I'm pretty sure every way has been proposed, and still yet we are with the Electoral College. According to Ed Goez, in a debate stated in the U.S. National Archives, the Founding Fathers were very smart. They had specific things they were trying to do. It goes beyond one man, one vote. It goes to the balance of power, and no matter what system you go to, there are huge, huge things that could happen. And so it's not just a simple debate. It's a very deep debate. Going back to what they said about the majority does not rule, the majority does not rule because the founders intended for them to not rule directly. If the majority were allowed to rule, small voices, such as minorities or smaller states, would not have a chance. The Electoral College system, as stated by William Kimberling of the Electoral College through the Federal Elections Committee, states, it is designed to work in a rational series of defaults. If in the first instance a candidate receives a substantial majority of the popular vote, then the candidate is virtually certain to win enough of the electoral votes to be elected president. In the event the popular vote is extremely close, then the election defaults to the candidate with the best distribution of popular votes. And I wanted to refer this back to their comments about the Gore and Bush election in 2000. The race between the popular vote was really, really close. It was pretty neck and neck. So the fact that if you have a minority president, it's based on really close polls. It's not based on a president who was so far out of the woods that he somehow managed to sweep it through the Electoral College. The Electoral College is set up to work to make sure that the president has a wide geographic distribution to win. Without this, presidents would just focus on large states like California or New York or Texas that are heavily populated and forget about the smaller states. Going back to what I said about the constitutional amendment to reform or eradicate the Electoral College, most of the proposals have had minimal legislative activity. Going back to Paige Whitaker and Thomas Neal, they state, however, some hearings were held and legislative activity occurred, but there was insufficient legislative support to obtain two-thirds votes of both houses of Congress necessary for approval of a constitutional amendment under Article 5. And the fact that we have an electoral college favors two large parties, mainly Republicans and Democrats. Without this, without the Electoral College, the popular vote rises, brings forth the opportunity for minority parties to come forth, and that could also create trouble when trying to have a president with a majority vote. Paige Whitaker and Thomas Neal again state that they assert the direct plan would weaken the present two-party system and result in growth of minor parties, third parties, and new parties. Today's two major parties are relatively broad, based both ideologically and geographically, and conduct nationwide presidential campaigns in order to assemble the requisite majority of 270 electoral votes. Similarly, the need to forge national coalitions have had a wide appeal and been a contributing factor for the comparative moderation of two major parties and the governmental stability enjoyed by the nation under the present system. Moreover, it's argued that the growth or emergence of more narrowly focused parties could have a divisive effect on national politics and result in governance by less stable coalitions similar to those in some parliamentary democracies. So if we allow smaller parties who aren't as strong as major parties to rule, that could hurt our government. Going back to the debate that I stated earlier, coming from the National Archives, Ed Goes says that, I mean, first of all, the mentality of the American public, and you really see this in primary, the mentality of the American public is politics is give me two choices. Don't give me a lot of choices. Thank you.